I'm walking home right now. I just have two coffees today, only two coffees. One long coffee and about 9 a.m. And now another coffee at 1 p.m. in a friend's house. And I just have to tell you, you know, I feel such a headache. My concentration is up, but so what's my sort of my heart rate. It's moving very fast and I'm out of breath. Ever wondered if coffee is healthy for you or not? Why do you feel the way you feel when you're drinking coffee? Why, waking up, you're looking for this nice warm cup of coffee to make you kick off your day? Why do you miss it when you're trying to quit? If the answer to these questions is yes and you're curious, you will find out in this video. We will go through the positive and the negative effects of coffee to our body, which compounds are responsible for this behavior, and an exclusive look into the state-of-the-art labs here at Queen's University Belfast, when we are conducting excellent research around coffee. I am Tassos Koidis and I'm a university prof in food science. So, is coffee good for you? Is it good for your body? Well, a true scientist will tell you that coffee consumption is regarded as beneficial for various health reasons. Coffee extract has been extensively investigated for various patholo-anatomical models in vitro and in vivo, and there are anti-inflammatory, antioxidant, and anti-carcinogenic effects. Well, no, stop. Let's just speak plain English. Can we all agree that after we're drinking this nice cup of coffee, we are feeling elevated, our mood is better, we feel warm, and we feel alerted? Well, why is that? Most of us admit that we are better in cognitive tasks. Our memory is better, our performance is better, we're even better at the gym. I will add something more here, that coffee is a powerful appetite suppressant. It helps people trying to lose weight, and gosh, it does work. I have seen it myself. But I guess I want to take you somewhere else. I want to tell you that coffee speaks to our brain, speaks to our heart. This warm cup of coffee, it just makes us feel warm in our heart, right? Well, probably too much. Well, for many, and that's true, a cup of coffee is company, my friends. It's a nice company. But what is inside coffee that makes us feel like that? There are a number of things in there, but the most important thing is, you guessed it, caffeine. To get nerdy for a second, caffeine is an alkaloid of the methyl xanthine class, and it's naturally found in plants. Not just in coffee, there are 60 different types of plants worldwide containing caffeine, and it is a central nervous system stimulant. In fact, it is the world's most widely applied psychoactive drug. And if that scared you, well, hold your horses, because I'm going to explain further. All coffee drinks have caffeine. It is naturally present in the beans and it is extracted in the coffee. This compound is responsible for most of the brain effects that we have seen. Even decaffeinated drinks have a little bit of caffeine, and it is down to the way that they are produced. Here is an example of some of the coffee drinks and their caffeine content. As you see, a regular cup of coffee contains about 130 milligrams. But notice the range for a second. It is amazing how large the variation is, mainly due to the coffee bean's composition, but also slightly influenced by the way it is prepared. If you are like me, you are consuming about 2 cups of coffee a day, and this is 200 milligrams of caffeine daily intake, which is the low to moderate zone in the table I just showed you. I am drinking coffee for over 20 years now, and I have never been off more than a couple of days in a row. I don't know, I just wanna sit down, but I don't know if I do sit down, whether I will relax.
So is coffee good for you, for your health, and for your body? Let's find out.
Yes, largely, it depends. The answer is more nuanced, but the data shows that is good for you. Large epidemiological studies often break the news. There was one a couple of years ago that was all over the place. It showed that moderate caffeine and coffee, I guess, consumption, 2 to 4 cups daily, has beneficial effects to your health. Not to your brain and your mood. We're now talking about your actual health, your life expectancy, your cardiovascular health. We are talking about protection against diseases such as diabetes, cancer, and metabolic syndrome. And it is not just caffeine which is responsible for that. There are all sorts of other compounds such as polyphenols which are contributing to this activity. in these large epidemiological studies, they follow thousands of people over the years and they try to link coffee consumption with health. But it's just a mere association. It's not a cause and effect type of study. For example, if we follow the people of Crete, which is an island in the south of Greece, who are coffee drinkers, we might establish the association between a low risk disease and a high coffee consumption, but say there might be other parameters at play. For example, the Mediterranean diet. Not that we have done a study administering coffee to thousands of people for a lot of years and understand the health. As a scientist, I do see the controversies between linking coffee consumption and health. And it is down to the way that the studies sometimes are designed and communicated that some things can be highlighted and some other things can be set aside. But of course, there are the facts that excessive and improper coffee consumption can negatively impact your health. It can influence your sleep. The majority of the adults with sleep problems, they should first check their coffee intake before even going to the doctor and complaining about their insomnia. It can also give you an adrenaline spike. And in some people, this manifests into tachycardia, that is, when your heart beats very, very fast. It can also influence your blood pressure. If you have a history of hypertension, you should be careful with excessive coffee consumption. And my friend's house, that coffee was strong. It was probably 12 grams of coffee in my cup. But I just shouldn't be like that. But I am like that. So I'm just wondering, what is your case? And if you decide, for whatever reason, to quit coffee completely and you are going cold turkey, cutting it immediately from one day to the next, you are going to experience withdrawal symptoms. That's a fact. If you are one of these people and coffee affects your sleep, try minimizing it. Try cutting it in half. Learn how your body reacts to a coffee, whether you have a lighter or a stronger coffee, and if it was a late or an earlier coffee.
It depends on several things, on your coffee habits, on your genetic sensitivity towards coffee, and at the time of the day that you are drinking coffee.
Caffeine has a half-life of 6 hours. So this means that if you had a cup of coffee in the morning at 9 a.m. and it was about 100 milligrams of caffeine, then by 9 p.m. in the night, you will still have 25 milligrams of caffeine in your blood. And for some people, this is significant. Okay, do we consume coffee and caffeine for pleasure or for purpose? This is a controversial subject. Are you the kind of person that you can't function in the morning until you have your cup of coffee? Do you feel lethargic? Do you feel craving coffee first thing in the morning or after lunch to feel productive and to feel concentrated at work? Well, maybe then. Or you have it as a habit. You have it to keep you company, as we said before, to have it as a nice way of getting your day by. Are these nice feelings that we get when we drink coffee, our mood elevated, due to the caffeine and the coffee, or due to the temporary withdrawal from caffeine? The pleasure that we get when we are satisfying our mini craving for caffeine, this temporary pleasure, this mood elevation, because we missed caffeine. We didn't have it for 12 hours. That is the end of the morning. And then I need it. I really need it. Caffeine needs about 30 minutes to be absorbed, and its effect lasts from 3 to 8 hours, according to the individual. So all of these nice feelings that we get immediately after consuming coffee, well, it's not the caffeine itself, it's the notion of us drinking coffee. Here at Queen's University Belfast, we conduct a lot of research around coffee. In the Institute for Global Food Security, we employ state-of-the-art techniques to understand the constituents of coffee, how they interact in the aroma of coffee, the roasting profiles, and what do they mean for coffee in terms of recovery of the most tasty of the ingredients. But also in milks, either dairy milks, that we have an excellent dairy production here in Northern Ireland, and also plant-based alternatives, such as oat milk, almond milk, coconut milk. And we are looking at things like how stable is the foam, how stable are the proteins at high temperature, the texture, the flavor of the milk in a coffee drink. Let me know down in the comments if you want a better breakdown of what we do in the lab here at Queen's. I want to finish this video to get to drink this coffee. I'm gonna try this coffee again now because it's so nice. You can't beat that feeling. And if you like this video, click the like button, leave a comment. How do you drink your coffee? How it affects you? If it does, are you trying to quit? Are you worried about your caffeine consumption? And also, what kind of other videos you would like to see me doing here? I'm a food scientist, so content can vary. I have a few things in the pipeline, but your support and your feedback is really useful for planning and for growth. And do consider subscribing, because it really does help a lot, a small channel such as this. So thanks a lot for sticking out until the very end. Stay safe, stay caffeinated, and see you in the next video. Bye!